everybody, and welcome to Collider TV Talk, TV Talk for TV fans. I'm your host, Sinéad de Vries, and this is our weekly show where we bring you the latest news from the world of television, plus talk about the week that was in TV. Joining me this afternoon is Josh Macuga.
What's up, Collider TV Talk fans? We are coming in hot today. We have all been at Comic-Con except for Sasha Perl-Raver. She's got all the energy in the world, and I'm just barely made it to the studio, but we have a ton to talk about. We're going to run the show a little bit differently today, but before I kind of break that down for you, Sinead, who else is here with us?
He's not lying, you guys. When I walked in, he was sleeping on the couch without his shoes on. It was great. Also here is Sasha Perl-Raver.
I am well-rested. I am energized. I had a protein shake minutes before I walked in here. I'm ready to go, y'all. Ready to go.
And also here is David Griffin.
I'm still tired, but I'm not going to lie. At the HitFix party Wednesday night with all these lovely people, and I was looking around and something was missing. I was missing the lovely, beautiful blonde Sasha Perl-Raver. It was actually a little sad. Every nice event that happened during the convention, I was like, man, it would really be nice if Sasha was here to experience this with us.
Well, we could just hang out now and hold hands and we can go anywhere. Where do you want to go? I got a grocery shop after this. You want to come?
Let's go back to San Diego. Let's do it again.
I just want to get drunk and see if I take Vashuga. My shoes, my shirt, whatever.
I'm waiting for those shoes to come out. I'm into some weird stuff, guys.
Wikifeet. I'm on it. I think I got like a 3.6 rating. Yeah. Sinead must be on Wikifeet. You know Sinead's on Wikifeet with like a 4.5.
There is.
You are. Somebody create a Wikifeet page for Sinead if it's not there. I promise you it's there.
Sinead'sfeet.tumblr.com.
No. I already have that. I already own that space. Okay. Yeah. No, you have to start your own. Be original,
I'm
Macuga.
I'm sorry. I will say, spoiler alert, don't put up the graphic. It's fine. When we do hit the Exorcist topic in our rundown here, I'm going to tell you a little bit about a story that happened to me at Comic-Con. It has to do with Sasha Perl-Raver. Anyhow, okay, guys, we're running this whole TV talk very different than what we've done since episode one, because there's so much news that dropped at Comic-Con, from superheroes to non-superhero shows to any show that was just there that we thought was newsworthy to talk about. We're going to basically run this entire episode until we get to the Mr. Robot review and Mr. Robot review.
Thank you.
And the Preacher review. It's all going to be highs and lows. So we're going to start with all the superhero show news, and then we're going to go into the other show's news, and then we're going to go to actually some news like that happened last week before Comic-Con, then go into the reviews. So it's going to be quick. It's rapid fire ish to a certain extent, but we have a ton to cover. I'm gonna stop talking now. I'm gonna hand it over to the lovely, the one with the magic feet, Sinead de Vries.
Yes! Missed you.
Good job, guys. Real clever. All right. Okay, let's get it started with the trailers. First up, Luke Cage.
Luke Cage was such a high for me. God, that dude is a badass. He uses a friggin' car door to take down a project. High. Super high.
Dude, you can't start a trailer and have ODB's Shimmy Shimmy Ya and not have me. I was watching it on the beach. And I was just like, I was getting so hyped. It looks awesome high.
I'm high on this. I'm just disappointed that we did a split the TV coverage. I was off covering Mr. Robot season 2, which is fantastic. Mr. Robot season 2, while Michael Medina and Ace were covering Luke Cage. I was a little bit jealous that I couldn't be on this panel because there was so much good footage, and that trailer was awesome.
High
for sure.
I was at Comic-Con HQ all weekend. We had this live stream going, and I went up to the thing, and all of the production office was around like one computer screen watching that panel. And when Luke Cage stood up and they played that trailer, that place went on fire. What did you think of the trailer?
I liked it. I think he kicked some serious ass, which I really like. I wish I would have been at the panel too, only because after the trailer, I was like, I just wanted a little bit of plot, just like something about his story, and I feel like maybe we would have seen that if we were at the panel. But so far, so good.
Yeah, the plot is he kicks ass.
Yeah. I know.
That's the plot.
But there are some clips they showed at the panel that we didn't get to see.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, they'll eventually get to us.
Oh, yeah.
But, that trailer is all we've seen so far. Mm-hmm. Obviously, for those people that waited in line since last week, they got that. All right, Sinead, what's next?
I can't call this one a trailer, you guys.
It's not.
It's Iron Fist.
It's just like an Iron Fist teaser.
Yeah.
All you really see one like movement of an iron fist, I guess, is when he like punches a wall off a building. It's very mysterious. It almost felt very Arrow-ish to me. Mm-hmm. I'm like, if this is full high, I'm like right here. on it. Mm. I wanted a little bit more because I feel like they've been shooting a ton. Like, we've seen images from it. So I'm like right here on it.
Well, curious to see what Sasha thinks, because I know she's, you know, read at least a few issues. So I'm curious, did you like the look of it? I mean, you had the yellow and green robes. I mean, what'd you
well,
think?
Well, it sounds like you're already excited
I love this story. I'm excited for it. Yeah.
Because you were kind enough to loan me the comics, I was a little bummed that it seems to start with like a weird plane crash. Mm-hmm. And I was like, so he crash lands into monks? That bummed me out a little bit, because I would like it to be more of a story of purpose as opposed to, oh, this accidental white guy gets all of these amazing powers. So I wasn't thrilled on it. Okay. I would put it like, of the stuff we saw, if it was like Luke Cage is up here, then Iron Fist made me go a little below.
Half.
Okay.
Yeah, I was like, but it also might have been like the come down, but I was not stoked on it.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah. Dave?
No, I'm high. Yeah, I'm definitely okay. High. Yeah, I'm in it.
What did you think, Sinead?
I agree with you, Sasha. First of all, there wasn't really much to it other than, you know, the whole monks thing. That's the only thing I can remember really is the monks and then him punching through the wall. But I wrote this on Twitter too. I was immediately disappointed that we didn't like actually see the Iron Fist, you know, or it just a punch to the wall, which is fine. And the trailer itself was beautifully shot, but I was also not, there was nothing that excited me about it.
Yeah. It's so early. I mean, there's still,
right. And it's a teaser. It's like I said too, like it's a teaser. So,
I mean, it kind of looks like Doctor Strange, like Benedict Cumberbatch, a homeless guy with a beard. I mean, you know, I mean, he's not homeless, but you know, when he's going off on his journey.
Homeless chic.
Homeless chic.
I heard somebody say something this weekend about the appearance of the stress beard.
Oh, yeah.
It's like Cumberbatch has it in Doctor Strange. Danny Rand has it in Iron Fist. Like, Stephen Amell had the stress beard in Arrow. Cumberbatch has it in Sherlock Holmes as well. Like, Sherlock Holmes is always clean shaven. He's got like a 5 or 6 day shadow of like stress beard. You're like, the stress beard is everywhere. It's kind of turning a little hipster.
It's one of those things where it's like, I'm so intense, I can't even bring my razor to my face because it's just like, that might happen.
Yeah. Stress beard.
Never know.
I've never had a stress beard. I've had like a lazy beard. So I feel like shave. I call mine a lazy beard, not a stress beard.
Yours is a manly beard. Yes. Yours is...
Mine gets curly real fast. I got to start combing it in a little while, start puffing it out. It's like, I kind of like pick it out like a fro.
Ooh.
Because my hair's all curl, so... Well,
close your ears for a second. Night of with the beard comb as he's in the jail cell.
Oh, yeah. Awesome. You got to have the beard comb.
All right, you're good. You're good.
Was that about Stranger Things?
No.
Night of. Last night's episode of Night of.
Okay, Shinesti, what's next?
All right. The Defenders, the logo, and the little teaser trailer for that as well.
Yeah, I think I'm high on that.
Yeah.
I really dug how they put that all together, especially like the font. It was almost like when I wrote like the fake ransom note to my mom as a joke when I was like in the 8th grade.
Wait.
When you had seen the thing and I was like, Ben's been kidnapped and I left the thing. Like, from it was like
What were you demanding? What were your demands?
Oh, it was like I wanted Oakley sunglasses or something.
Of course, you did. On the back of your neck.
Yeah, that was like, cool. Yeah, that was a pro volleyball player. But like, they took all of the fonts from all of the things and made that Defenders. Dope. I'm high on that. I thought that was really cool.
I thought that looked amazing. And I think, so I watched it in order of Luke Cage, then Defenders, and then Iron Fist. And that's why I think it was like,
Yeah,
it was awesome. The logo looked rad and it was so simple. They didn't have to show us anything. They just knew how to get us hyped with literal fonts. Just fonts.
Fonts.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Just getting excited about fonts.
I know, but it's true.
David.
No, I mean, I love the narration. I mean, kind of like the hand, the formation of the hand, like over. It's like, you know, you think you guys are here, you think you know what you're doing, you have no idea what you're up against, and I love that. I can't wait. This is the Avengers. We're getting Avengers on television. You know, it's gonna be great.
Sinead, let me ask you this. I know that like you haven't watched every episode of Daredevil or every episode of Jessica Jones, and we've been like trying to get you to watch this stuff. Do these trailers from Comic-Con get you excited to maybe watch these shows?
Well, see, I loved Daredevil, and Jessica Jones I didn't love.
Yeah.
I didn't
Preach,
love.
Sister.
I got through a few episodes. I think I dropped out after 5 or 6.
Mm-hmm.
I tried. It just wasn't speaking to me for some reason. Yeah.
It didn't give you that Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. fuzzy feeling in the stomach?
It's the cheesiness in me, I swear. But the Defenders teaser trailer was awesome. I loved it. I loved the little line at the end, like, how can you save anyone if you can't even save yourselves?
Yeah.
And it's just so weird to me that I was more stoked on that than Iron Fist. Like, yeah, that just shows that there was like something about the Defenders, as little as we got, that's just like, yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I love that actor, the guy whose voice we heard, whose name I can never remember.
Stick. He yeah, in Daredevil.
But what's his, oh God, he's so great. And like, actress, he's such a beautiful, like, his voice is so gravelly and it's so deep and it's so much angst in it. It was so good. Yeah. I thought that was rad.
I'm really, really excited for the team up.
Scott Glenn.
Scott Glenn.
Boom, shakalaka.
Mm. Yeah.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
Almost the trippiest trailer we saw, American Gods stars.
Yeah, I'm totally down with this. I am. I don't know. I honestly don't know. I don't want to read anything about it because I want to be so surprised by the show. And I'm hoping that it gives me that, like, way better feeling than what I'm getting from Preacher.
Dude.
Because this looks incredible. Especially Ian McShane. Dude can do no wrong. Like, he could read a Paula Deen cookbook from 1991 about, like, an old biscuit that she made. I'd be like, that biscuit is incredible.
But Ian McShane is so wonderful that he probably would do that because he knows that Paula Deen is a terrible, terrible human being. Yes. No, it looked sick. And it made me go, once again, like, stars.
Yes.
Stars crushing it so hard. It looks so good. So I had a moment of trepidation because they just announced that Dane Cook is going to be on the show.
What?
And I was like, I talked to a buddy of mine who's all about Neil Gaiman, and he was like, no, you do not understand. That character is Dane Cook. Like, they didn't cast him act. Cool. They just cast him to be himself. So it's perfect. You're going to hate him, but you're going to want to hate him on the show. Like, it is perfect. I can't wait.
So, like, you know, when you're walking, right?
Wait, you have to crouch down and be...
People, because they walk. Yeah. And you know how they when they walk, they use their arms when they walk? Because, like, that's a thing. Like, people when they walk... That's my Dane Cook impersonation.
Yeah, that's pretty spot on. Yep. That was it. Killed it.
I'm really high on this. I know everybody's pumped about Ian McShane, some of the other top actors they have in the show. I'm really excited to see Ricky Whittle, who was in The 100, which is my favorite CW show. He's playing Shadow Moon. Looks like he's going to be the main character in the series. If you're catching up with The 100, you know, good, more power to you. But I mean, Ricky Whittle, he's such a good actor. I wish he could have done more with The 100, but I'm glad that he's on this show now. He's one of those guys who's very quiet, you know, reserved. He's got like that, everything just behind the eyes, you know, just boiling over. So I think he's going to be a good actor. This could hopefully, you know, propel him to more stardom.
No, this looks full star-making performance.
American
totally.
Gods had a cool installation too at Comic-Con, which they had a little bit of real estate. So I think Starz is pretty pumped about the series.
And this is pre-Lionsgate buy, so it'll be interesting to see. Yeah.
Well, I actually had, I met up with a friend of mine who is working at Fremantle. This is the most money Fremantle has ever spent on a show. They are putting all of their resources into it. They want this to be a huge success. They want this to be like their Game of Thrones, basically. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I have huge belief in it.
And I know we're not talking about this in today's show, but it's interesting to see. Starz is in an interesting place right now. Outlander season 2 set the record for their most watched premiere. But Power.
We call that the Griffin effect.
The Griffin effect, because people listen. Thank you. But Power had their highest premiere. Power season 3, their premiere was the biggest premiere of all time on their show. It was like almost 3 million views. So, I mean, that's big numbers.
It's climbing.
That's a big number. Stars is doing well. Stars is growing. Yeah.
Sinead, we were talking about American Gods before the show started. What were your thoughts on it?
I mean, I immediately said to David, I was like, I don't get it, but it looks awesome.
Yeah.
I don't know anything about this story. I have no idea what I watched. I was like, what? But it was really, really cool. Really cool.
And there's another show. I guess, you know what? Let's skip down to that. Let's go to the Legion.
I knew you were going to say that.
Trailer.
Next.
Sorry.
Why, that one was even more.
Because that was even more confusing. Yeah. Like, I have no idea what that is. That looks like some crazy indie film directed by Guillermo del Toro. Uh-huh. I don't know.
And Michelle Gondry.
Yes.
Michelle Gondry and Guillermo del Toro together.
I'm putting it right here. Again, it looks
cool. What? Oh my God, you guys. He's drunk. Go
impossible.
Home.
What's
drunk.
In here?
All right, fine. I'll go to here.
He's got some funny water up in this glass.
It looks so confusing.
Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? So my one big frustration with the Marvel trailers was I was like, Marvel is using really good music and nice voiceover in all of theirs, but Legion used dope visuals, rad storytelling, amazing, like the conceits that they put in motion in that trailer had me going, holy F, this is probably going to be my favorite newest show on television. And I felt like where the other shows, they got you with the ODB, Legion got you with the like
DBO. I don't know what it is. I don't know. I just
what, like, the DVL?
What's ODB?
Old Dirty Bastard. That's Shimmy Shimmy Ya, which is what the Luke Cage trailer used. What Legion used, though, was like...
Josh is freestyling
that
over here.
You didn't even need music for that. If you just watch those crazy-ass visuals and the way the story is unfurling, it was giving me so much life. Yeah. I can't believe... This, it should be like... All the way.
I don't know. Your actual noise didn't match your thumb.
You remind me of that one SpongeBob episode where he visits the town and everyone talks like that. If you haven't seen it, go watch it, you guys. Sinead, it's real good.
Great reference.
Thank you.
That thing is so high, it's like a Ron Jeremy boner.
I'm up there floating with you, Sasha. This is a definite high. I'm telling you, do not sleep on my boy Dan Stevens now. Downton Abbey, son. Downton Abbey.
He left
coming from Downton Abbey, taking a risk, leaving the show, doing this, doing big things. It looks so good. Inception, Doctor Strange, The Butterfly Effect with Ashton Kutcher. Oh, I just dropped that one. Oh. All combined together. Bam. Legion, I don't know how they're gonna craft him in this series, but he's supposed to be the mutant son of Professor Xavier. He has a dissociative disorder, where his other personalities take over. So he has multiple personalities and they take over and control him. And I don't know how they're going to use this in the show, if they're going to follow what the comic books did, but Legion is a crazy character.
So it's like United States of Terra.
Yeah.
Yep.
Meets everything else.
Butterfly effect.
And Inception.
And Inception.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And I got yelled at by Sinead when I said like this, so I'm guessing it's a high for you too.
Yeah, Sinead. I loved it. It was like a freaking mind trip. I loved every single minute of it. I agree with you. And they showed us so much. Like, and I still have no idea what any of it means, which means it's a great trailer. If I got to see that much, and I still am so intrigued by it.
Okay.
Dude.
All right.
So basically, you're wrong.
Yep. Okay. I've been known to be wrong every now and then, all the time.
Out of everything I watch, I think Legion is the thing I'm most hyped on.
Mm. Okay. All right. Sinead, what's next?
All right. So back up to Daredevil being renewed for season 3.
I think we can do this short. Hi.
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 I think it was an obvious thing to do. Okay.
Cool little trailer. Yeah, yeah. I liked it. Yeah.
Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. officially announced what we've all been speculating for forever.
Yeah.
And they introduced Gabriel Luna as Ghost Rider.
You have been cleared. You were getting so much crap. Remember when we talked about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and talking about how the Comic-Con trains had Ghost Rider? Like, maybe Ghost Rider's going to be the show. Everybody's like, no, Josh, you're wrong. It's not blah, 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 blah. You were right, sir.
We have been confirmed
a Ghost Rider. This man does know what he's talking about sometimes.
I will take it. Right after the panel, right after they announced it's going to be Robbie Reyes. It's not Johnny Blaze.
He's
going to have a Dodge Charger.
Right.
Obviously, we're going to have the words Dodge Charger dropped a billion times within the show. So Dodge gets their plug while they pay for the car to be in the show. And that Gabriel Luna, I think the only thing you'd know him for, he was Taylor Kitsch's gay lover in True Detective season 2. So not like exactly a huge part, but in a not so well-received show. But I got to, the coolest thing I did all Comic-Con was I got to interview basically the entire cast of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. right after they did it. So I was asking, the producers, all of this stuff about Ghost Rider. And when I asked Clark Gregg about Ghost Rider, he was like, I can't wait to yell at him. Because, Clark Gregg, he does a lot of yelling at the S.H.I.E.L.D. agents. And then I pitched him my superhero, Shark Dressed Man, to be in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And it was quickly thrown aside. But this is a high for me. I proved right, and I'm so excited because it's a named superhero in a show that deserves a named superhero.
Clark Gregg does not know what he is missing. I'm a little sad it's not Nick Cage, but I'm still excited for it.
Okay.
I'm excited that we're going to see Ghost Rider on the small screen. I'm a high on it for sure.
Sinead, our in-house Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. fan.
You guys have not caught up on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. yet. So now when all this news came out, I was like, get away from me. I don't want to hear anything. But it sounds cool. I need to catch up. Need to.
Okay, what's next?
Let's see here. So skipping over Legion, Legends of Tomorrow, the first look at Comic-Con, Justice Society of America cast revealed, and the Legion of Doom.
Dave, let's
see. Oh, my goodness. So Saturday, spent all day in Ballroom 20. About 6 hours worth watching several panels. 4 hours of that was spent with the CW panels. Some were good, some were not good. This one was kind of in the middle. A lot of these shows haven't started production yet.
Yeah.
So a lot of it was just kind of Q&A with fans and just discussing things. At least I liked about this panel that they did set up what they were going to talk about, the Legion of Doom. Mm-hmm. We do know that Eobard Thawne's coming back. We have some cool, interesting characters we're going to see there. So at least we got some information. Overall, I'm high on this. I liked Legends of Tomorrow. I'm excited to see how the JSA, the Justice Society of America, is going to play a role in the upcoming season. I think, in my opinion, the more superheroes, the better. That's always a good thing.
Yeah, like, I mean,
it's like a 75% high for me.
Yeah, like, I would say I'm like about 60. I liked the trailer. We talked about it afterwards. I thought it was decent. Again, the show is very confusing to me and sometimes appears cheesy at points, but I'm not sold on it via this trailer. Like, it didn't shun me the other way. With all this time travel, they're able to reintroduce a ton of these characters that have either been killed off or killed on or whatever we're even saying about this time
travel. Because it's time travel, yeah.
So, Sasha?
Sasha. Yeah, see?
Shoshana!
Know the name. I don't watch Legends of Tomorrow, so I watched it. It looked interesting, but I reserve judgment because it's not a show that I am invested in. I mean, I'm not invested in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. either, but I know Ghost Rider and I've seen them movies.
Right.
I think that the next one, we're getting into the CW part of the superhero Comic-Con. So what's next, Sinead?
Katie Cassidy is going to be a series regular across all the CW shows.
Wow. Okay, so this is interesting because when I started doing Schmoes, everyone was like, you look like Katie Cassidy. Uh-huh. And I was like, oh, yes. I don't see it. But okay, but I hated her on Gossip Girl. Uh-huh. And now, like,
you'd hate her even more on Arrow.
Well, that's what everybody has said. And hearing this, I just like people started reaching out to me on Twitter and they were like, ah! So I feel like the fan reaction is, no, the loyal fan base was saying, F this chick. They were like, really? Oh, she's the worst. Yeah. Why are we putting her on everything?
A lot of people blame season 3 and 4 of Arrow on her. Katie Cassidy and her inclusion as like a crime fighting superhero who just wears a lot of buckles and like can kind of kick and punch a little bit. She runs real slow. Like her all of her action scenes are really awkward. It's just not great.
I'm not a fan of what they do with her character. Remember in season 2, she was at Arrow, she was like, you know, going through AA and all this kind of stuff. This kind of dragged her along, didn't know what to do with her. But I do like the version she played on The Flash. Because currently, right now, as far as we know, she is locked up in one of those vaults in Star Labs. So she's still around. And I like that version of her as a villain. She plays, because Katie Cassidy, because it seems like a lot of people don't like her. She's very unlikable. She plays a great villain on screen. So I'm excited to see that version of her. I'm going to do a reserve thumbs up.
Sinead, were you a fan of Katie Cassidy on Gossip Girl, or or were you in the camp?
She wasn't very nice in that show,
nope,
I remember.
She wasn't very nice. Yeah. I mean, I hated her actual character that she played. What? I didn't really like her.
Wasn't she setting somebody up in the show? Wasn't she like pretending to be somebody else?
She was like evil as all evil can be, and they just would not get rid of her.
Yeah.
And they dragged her storyline out forever, and she's the type of person that's like,
I feel like she just got like really good agents that like are like, hey, she's signed a 30 episode.
Or a dad. She's got a really good dad.
Her dad's somebody.
Cassidy. Work with me here.
Gotcha. Yeah. My bad. Mm-hmm. My bad. I did not know that. I guess I'm so usually so bored with her appearances in Arrow that I'm just like, I don't really care.
I'm not even gonna Wikipedia that. Shinasty,
what's next?
All right, the season 3 trailer for The Flash.
My favorite thing, obviously, that came out of that CW panel. Another like time travel, like trippy mind thing of like what happens when you mess with the Flashpoint paradox, like we've talked about. High for me on Flash.
Again, I don't watch the show, but you know what was awesome was The Flash showing up in that rad Justice League trailer. That's a side note. David?
Again, more superheroes, the better. The more Flashes are, the better. I'm excited about this. This is my favorite panel, the 4 panels that they had for the CW at Comic-Con. This was my favorite. I can't wait to see. Kid Flash looks so good when you see him running in there. I'm so excited for this.
He's got his hair. Sinead?
I mean, I don't watch The Flash, but I will say that I still prefer the CW Flash costume to the one I saw in the Justice League trailer.
Oh, I liked the Justice League costume, but I mean, I was just blinded by the Momoa, so I liked everything.
Yeah, and there's Momoa. Real quick before we go on, guys, if you want to see some of David's breakdowns, my breakdowns from the CW panels at Comic-Con, we shot some live reactions right after them. There was a dinosaur moment. Tomorrow one, but you guys can check those all here on Collider, as well as every video, every interview, everything they did from Comic-Con. Geez, every time I went in those rooms, it was some kind of crazy interview going on, especially the fact we got to meet Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, a man who was extremely excited to meet all of us. Wink, wink. Sinead, what's next?
Supergirl. No footage, but the panel spilled some stuff, maybe?
So this was my most anticipated panel of all. Even though Supergirl it's not my favorite show of the WB shows, superhero shows. It was the one I was looking forward to because it's going to have a new look. It's going to be in the CW now. It's not going to be on CBS. I wanted to see that new look. And immediately when they started off the panel, they said, production has not started yet. We start in a week or so. There is no new footage to show. But we have this nice, you know, recap of season 1 we put together. I'm like, So that was disappointing to me. I mean, there's production schedules. I can't blame them for not starting production yet. But
the literally started today.
Yeah, they started today, which is fine. But the cast seems to have, what I did learn, this cast has great chemistry together. They really do seem generally happy to be around each other. Everybody was laughing. They were fun. The Q&A with the fans was good. I can't really complain about the panel itself. It's just I was just disappointed because I wanted to see just a little taste of what it's going to look like, because I'm really interested to see how the CW is going to change from being on the CBS.
Yeah, I mean, again, since I wasn't there, all I can go by is on David's.
You got to meet the new Superman.
Good word. Yeah,
yeah. The whole thing's on YouTube. I watched it on YouTube.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I just, again, we didn't get anything, so I'm going to give it a low, but.
I thought they confirmed that they're already planning crossovers for all the shows, which is what we anticipated, but now it's 100% confirmed. And I thought that, like you said, David, you could really see the cast chemistry. And it was so obvious that this was like a really cohesive, fun unit. And I think it's going to be a lot better on the CW. And I feel like the CW is going to give them, like, the vibe I was getting during the panel was CBS had certain expectations, the CW has very different expectations, and it fits more within what they want to do anyway. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think it's going to be cool. I liked it. I watched it online. I give it a high.
Shenasty.
Honestly, I feel like if they start production today, then there should have been some sort of pictures of set or something, because I feel like this is their one opportunity to get people totally back on board with the show. And if it meant like taking just a couple pictures of like maybe something that looks a little bit different, because the general consensus that I heard from everyone is that everybody was disappointed that they got nothing about the new look
Supergirl.
Wait, sorry, I just want to go real quick off what Sinead said. She brings up a good point. This is my biggest beef. The Flash, of all the four panels, the Flash was the best at telling us where our characters are going to be when the show starts. They obviously have scripts written, but there was no mention. It's like, hey, where's your character going to be? What's your character's mindset during the scene? The Flash came out the most confident because right now, in terms of ratings, critical appeal, they are the highest rated, you know, the best show on CW. So they come out talking about, this is what we're doing, this is where our characters are, this is what they're going through. Supergirl, I'm like, well, what's your character doing? Like, how is she reacting from what happened in season one? We got none of that. Mm. That's another reason why I was disappointed too.
Interesting.
Sorry. Get a little feisty about that.
Feisty.
I like it.
All right, so that was all of our, oh no, we got one more.
One more.
I'm sorry, one more. Sinead.
Arrow, season 5 trailer.
You know, you were low. I think I'm high on this. I'm hoping that you, I mean, sort of low.
Yeah, I was like, I have hope.
Yes.
I have hope. I don't think the show can get worse.
Okay.
I have hope.
Yeah. Oh, famous last words, my friend. Famous last words.
It almost feels like
everybody
a reboot.
Everybody at home needs to knock on wood, like, right now. Sorry, Cody. Sorry.
The sound.
At this point, Cody, he's just in autopilot after this week. I saw Cody outside of Hall H. I was like, what's up, Cody? He's like, he was not. Yeah. He's not a happy guy. But I like that it almost feels like a little bit of a reboot, a little bit of a thing. We're finally going to get some of that Russian flashback we've been talking about for a while. So I'm going to go high on Arrow.
Okay. So again, I don't watch the show. I watched the trailer, and my first thought was, this is not going to get me to watch the show.
Really?
That was my, because you guys have been talking about it so much, and I was like, maybe I'll give it a chance. We've been talking about like it's going to be like this and that. And I watched it, and I was like, this show looks so.
It's gonna be like The Wire.
It's The Wire.
It's The Wire on CW.
It's The Wire.
Idris Elba's coming to CW.
It is The Wire.
It is. It's The Wire, but with bows and arrows.
Exactly.
Yeah, no. Yeah.
All right. Okay, so that wraps up our superhero section of our Comic-Con rundown. Now into some non-superhero Comic-Con action. Sinead, what do we got up top?
I feel like I can feel David's excitement.
He's like, yes. I looked down. Yeah, I'm ready.
He's like, All right, Rick and Morty season 3 trailer. Also, Dan Harmon saying his dream guest star would be Vin Diesel.
Yeah. Ours too on TV Talk. We love you, Vin Diesel.
You're not even in TV. Just come hang out with us on TV Talk. We can talk about some weird stuff. Talk about Triple X.
We'll all wear tank tops. We'll drink Coronas.
Yes.
Oh my God. We'll do it on the stoop of the Toretto House in East LA.
Yep.
Dude.
Done and
please.
Done. Please. TV Talk live on location.
I love him.
Yes. I'm in.
Vince.
Hey, can we talk a little bit about Rick and Morty? Is that okay? Can we talk a little about Rick and Morty? Are you guys, done?
Go ahead. All right.
Go ahead.
Rick and Morty. You were the guy that finally turned me on to Rick and Morty, and I'm so happy that you did, because I binged all 2 seasons of that. That show is. St- stupid funny.
Stupid funny.
That is hysterical.
Rick and Morty. I was covering TV all weekend. Rick and Morty was the hardest panel to get into. Even didn't have to wait in line hardly at all in Ballroom 20. I got right into Ballroom 20 for everything I needed to get into. Rick and Morty, the Indigo Ballroom at the Hilton Bayfront, was the hardest one to get into. We're in the hot sun, the hot 90 degree weather, whatever it was out there for like, you know, 2 hours. But it was well worth it because we got to see an animatic. It wasn't a finished product. We got to see an animatic of Rick who turned himself into or turned into a pickle. And basically, he has to find a way to get out of this jail. It's a bunch of rats trying to get at him because he's a pickle. But he takes a rat brain and puts it, you know, inside his super suit that he makes for himself. And it's just him slicing rats up. Just cutting rats up, blood everywhere. I can't wait. I know. It makes no sense. It's so cool.
You wouldn't think
it's
that good. This pitches you well on Rick and Morty. Just watch trust it. David and
wait,
I.
What?
On
I
Rick
literally
Morty.
You can
know
watch
nothing.
On Hulu. You can watch Hulu. Hulu. You can watch it on Hulu.
Okay.
Hulu.
You can watch it on a helicopter. It's an animated show on Adult Swim. Dan Harmon, who did Community, he created this. It's just so strange and off the wall. And it's an adult animated comedy. I will subscribe it other than I saw a lot of people dress as cosplay as it, so it's very popular. David talking about the panel. I loved hearing what they all had to say about it. It's a really, really cool show.
I just watched the like animatic or whatever that they released, and it looks so twisted. Yeah. Twisted in the best ways.
There's the Purge episode.
Purge episode season two, yeah.
Is something that I've never seen before. And it's good. Unbelievable.
All right, well, I think I'm sold. I'll try.
Mm-hmm. All right, what's next?
Best news ever, possible Degrassi reunion.
We're starting with Sinead on this one. Sinead, go ahead.
This is like amazing. So I looked all this up because I actually didn't hear anything about this at all, but I saw a bunch of news today that basically like the whole cast got back together. There's like pictures minus Drake, which is also really
typical.
Sad because Jimmy needs to come back. But I actually wanted to ask you guys because I haven't heard any of the news about the actual reunion other than what I read on the rundown.
Yeah.
I just saw people speculating because pictures surfaced.
Yeah, pictures surfaced. They're talking about it. They said like Drake probably won't be in the reunion, but never say never. All of the cast started like dropping like weird hints and stuff about certain things. So when cast starts dropping hints about things,
and they were like checking in with them, they were like, "This person's up to this right now," and it's just like no one's ever paid any attention to the Degrassi cast in years. So I thought it was interesting that they're like, "See what this person's up to now," because that usually means something.
It's the Drake. It's the Drake.
It's the Drake. I do feel like we should be specific. This is Degrassi, the new class.
The new class.
The next generation.
Oh, excuse me, the next generation.
Get your head out of your ass. Because
Degrassi High, you weren't even alive.
I've seen it, though. I've seen it. I love it. But this is like, Emma is what's-her-face's kid, the one with the crazy hair.
Yeah.
She's your daughter.
Saved by the Bell is to me what Degrassi is to you.
Oh, God. Every episode, at least 10 times each.
Yes. Okay. All right. Sinead. What's next?
Prison Break.
Dude.
Okay, here's my. First of all, great the footage clip. Is great awesome, clip, yeah. right? Here's my story from Comic-Con, right? So, fourth floor of the Hilton Bayfront, they had this balcony that they were doing interviews from for like so you could see out. And I had to run up there to grab one of the producers and then run back down. And I'm running out of the elevator. And if you guys follow me on Instagram or Twitter or whatever, this weekend I had wild pants on the whole time. And so I had these American flag pants. And I'm running from the elevator, and I come, and the first person I run into is Wentworth Miller. I was like, "Oh, sorry, man." I was like, "Love you on Prison Break." He's like, "Love your pants more." So, and then I caught the Prison Break footage. It looks awesome.
Oh
I'm
my God.
So psyched for that show to come back, man. I just something about Prison Breaking that's just awesome,
dude.
I'm high.
So
I'm super high.
Then. Super high. Yeah. It looks so good, and it's simple. It's just one scene, but I was like, keep going.
Do you get Audience Network on your cable? Do you have Audience Network?
I think so. Yeah, DirecTV. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Audience Network has been playing Prison Break nonstop. Like middle of the night, I'll wake up and I'll catch like an episode of Prison Break. Oh, it's so good.
So I don't know anything about it. I always just guess. I'm like, why do they keep going in prison? Why don't they learn their lesson and just stay out of prison? But the clip looked really.
I know. We know they solved it. The cops keep that Ice-T keeps giving us long expositionary things at the beginning of whatever show he's on.
Dude. But because of that clip, I want to check this out. I love the whole thing about the gum being a butterfly effect.
Yeah.
You know, and just
third butterfly effect.
And let's see how much Ashton Kutcher we can get into this.
Yeah.
Show.
So I'm looking. That clip was great. I'm looking forward to watching.
Absolutely.
This. I'm gonna check it out.
So good. I love Wentworth Miller too.
All right, let's pick it up a little bit. We've got a lot to get to here.
Sinead,
let's go. What's next?
Sherlock season 4 and EP's teasing the darkest episodes yet.
Yeah, it's stress. The stress beard.
Uh-huh. Look at
stress
David.
Beard took me from a super high to like 97. David.
Sherlock's losing his mind. This is going to be fantastic. Look at him. He's just
Yeah.
Poor Benedict Cumberbatch. He's just going through a lot. I mean, he talked to Strang. I mean, he's just a stressed out man. Oh, I feel bad for the guy.
Poor Benedict Cumberbatch.
Poor Benedict Cumberbatch. No, I can't wait. I'm just so sad we have to wait till 2017. I thought the Christmas special was, our holiday special was just okay. It was all right, but I'm excited for season four.
If anybody wants to know what I think, you can just go to Schmo's show, like 224-ish.
You don't like Sherlock? Well, you're not a Sherlock fan?
She's not a big Cumberbatch fan.
I'm not a big Sherlock fan either.
We're fine.
Did they solve it?
They solved it.
Next.
Oh, no.
Sinead, go next.
Designated Survivor. Next
yes.
trailer.
Yeah. Yes. We talked about this when we were talking about the upfronts.
Yeah.
This is the one show that I saw and I was like, I'm in. It's a great idea. Yeah. Hi.
Hi.
Hi. What's your
super
giggle?
High.
I was thinking about something.
What were you thinking about?
Is this a little hot in here?
It's a little hot.
So you know, like when you're dying. Hot and you have sweat going down your back and you can kind of just feel it like slowly going into your butt. Like that's
which,
what I'm going through right now.
Speaking of solving it, things going down your butt. Did you guys see the thing that I right tweeted now. At you about the homeless guy who was poop bombing people on the street? He would like take his own feces and shove it down other people's pants.
Oh,
and I was
no.
like, that is an episode of CSI that I would watch the shit out of, quite literally.
That is pretty good.
Oh my God. They solve it. By the way, they found the guy.
Oh, but then like, I really like that made you giggle.
Yeah,
I really enjoyed that.
Well, you know, when that last little trickle goes down, he was like,
you can feel it.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
He's not getting it.
It's so
extra
fucking hot
in
here. It's so hot
yeah,
here
we're
today,
dying.
You guys.
We're
right.
dying.
Okay, Riverdale, you guys, the newest yeah! Riverdale image and all the conversation from Comic-Con. Yeah.
I'm up. I'm
oh,
high.
God.
I'm
so
excited. I've joined. Yay! After the footage came out and after one of the people from Riverdale came to Comic-Con HQ, they were super cool. And the one guy called my pants. He's like, those look like you should wear those in Riverdale. I was like, oh, cool.
Which hey. Pants were they?
They were the ones with all like the hot dogs and the ping oh. bang plows and the popcorn.
Are you on board yet?
I'm on board, yeah. Oh, I mean, yeah. after you compare it, was it Gossip Girl
yes.
meets-
No, it's Dawson's Creek meets Twin Peaks.
Yeah.
Okay, I don't know much
Dawson's
about Dawson's Creek, but I'm-
But you
yeah.
said it tested higher than Gossip Girl,
That's
which
right.
is saying a lot.
Yeah, I'm done. I mean, I'm in.
So Lena Dunham was on Instagram and commented on one of the producers' photos. There was a picture from mm-hmm. Riverdale at like in the Warner Brothers pitch meeting. And she was like, I got the secret agency link and it's the best thing I've seen. I can't wait for more.
That was the one oh, thing so about Comic-Con I was disappointed so in because Wednesday night I was a little bit too preoccupied with getting turnt. So I was, mm-hmm. I really, but I wanted to watch the pilot.
Fam.
They actually
yeah.
had the pilot. So
yeah.
I didn't get a chance to see it.
I can't wait. But everything I've been reading says it's amazing. I think this is so deep in my wheelhouse. Sinead, me and you, Riverdale.
So excited.
Oh my God.
So excited.
All right, Sinead, next.
Star Trek, Discovery Ship image and tease from the No Information press conference. We
caps.
Got nothing.
Yes.
I love the how you read the caps out.
I was there. I was at that stupid press conference. It was for the Star Trek 50th anniversary, okay? And listen, I'm not like a huge Star Trek fan, obviously, from the early stuff, and I'm nothing against people that like it. I just wasn't. But I was shoved in this press conference because I thought we were supposed to get red carpet one-on-ones. We didn't get those originally. Eventually, we got a couple of them. But they asked like a couple questions, and then William Shatner talked for like 25 minutes about a Stephen Hawking interview that he really enjoyed. So we literally got nothing. And then when I asked the producers, executive producers, Rod Roddenberry's son, Rod Roddenberry, Gene's son, and a couple of the other ones, they were like, we can't tell you anything. The executive producer was like, so why are you here? Like, well, I understand it's a 50th anniversary, but again, like I'm getting nothing from this. The ship looks just like the old Enterprise, like an original drawing from back in the days, but I'm just gonna go low. I mean, we just didn't get anything. We're like the nerd mecca, the geek mecca, and you gave no Star Trek thing
yeah.
in the TV show.
I mean, I'm gonna go low on the interview and on the press for it, but I'm gonna go. I mean, high on the show. I'm excited to see it, but it's just so early. They could have made something up.
Yep, exactly.
Like we're gonna see new planets.
Yes.
We're gonna see some new aliens.
Something.
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 Could have made something up.
I love that press you guys please. Are this and Supergirl. You're like, you didn't tell me anything, so you get a low.
Yeah.
Well, what about waiting?
Yeah, what about me?
What about waiting until something is ready to be shown?
Well, oh. What about giving me 10 seconds?
Mm-hmm. It's Comic-Con.
10 seconds. It's Comic-Con.
You can just make something up and people, nerds will go crazy. Like, oh my gosh.
Don't mess with it. Don't mess with Shinasty.
Okay.
All right, Sinead, next.
Son of Zorn Comic-Con trailer.
You know what? I'm really high on this show. I'm really excited about it. But the Comic-Con trailer was the same thing we've seen already.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So
nothing
low.
New.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
Can't wait for the show. Ditto.
Yeah,
excited for the show.
Okay.
Gonna watch it.
Walking Dead season 7 teaser trailer and teasing the bashing with Lucille.
Josh, why don't you talk about what you thought about this? I think you're a little more positive on it than
yeah,
some
Yeah, I was really positive.
What?
Until somebody started yelling at me.
Jesus Christ,
God,
you guys.
Help us all. You
this was a great last show. Thank you for watching TV Talk.
Dead. Can you make up your damn mind how you feel about this show?
I can't. I am such a waffler when it comes to all of this stuff. I'm sorry. For some reason, it was a little emotional.
Eeny, meeny, flashback. Miney, flashback, Mo.
What about
flashback.
The fact that, like, as this stuff's going, I'm like, I'm getting nauseous because it's just
I started skipping it, yeah. Skipping ahead.
Whatever.
That was garbage.
We did get to see Jesus make a pretty cool move. He did, like, some spin move, like, ooh, and slicing people up. That was kind of cool. That looked cool.
Like, crap.
Whatever, we're all going to watch the pilot.
The funny thing is, like, I'm complaining, but I'm going to watch it. I'm going to contribute views to the show.
I'm going to watch the first episode of this next season, and then I'm going to let you grew-ups, love you. Talk about it until the last one. And then on the last episode, I'm going to be like, I didn't watch the season, you guys, because remember, it sucks.
All right, what's next, Sinead?
Game of Thrones, season 7 tease.
Okay. He's doing her Game of Thrones dance. There
Victory
you go.
Dance. Oh, yeah. My God.
It's good.
They showed us nothing, they gave us everything.
Basically, they showed, like, slow motion of a needle on a sewing machine, and I was like, that's brilliant. It's amazing. Give that sewing machine an Emmy. It's amazing. So good.
They put, like, the gold. They put some gold paint on something. They hammered. It's so good. And then they just, like, in production. I was like, oh, God. Yeah. Oh, God.
Oh, my Lord.
Oh, my God. All the way. Hi.
I'm definitely high on Game of Thrones. Always high on Game of Thrones. Always high on Game of Thrones.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
All right, Fear the Walking Dead, Josh's favorite show.
This is going to be awesome. This is stupid. It's like him ringing a bell and like a bunch of zombies in Mexico. Who knows?
I thought the Fear the Walking Dead thing was actually pretty cool looking. When, like, a body comes out of the hotel window and you realize that's not a jumper, that's a zombie going to the first floor direct route. I thought that looked pretty cool, actually.
Again, we had nothing about if the show's actually going to be good.
No, but that trailer looked awesome. Yeah. And it looked way better than the stupid trailer for the other thing where I was like, that just, oh my God.
Okay.
Yeah, I feel like The Walking Dead, except for the Comic-Con reel for the main series, they usually cut a good trailer. I mean, I always pick on Michael Bay and Transformers, but I mean, the trailers, I'm like, that looks kind of cool. The way he cuts the trailers together. But yeah, The Fear of the Walking Dead, I'm high on the trailer.
Look cool.
I'm high.
Yeah. Sinead, last one.
The Man in the High Castle season 2.
I will say, I loved the first season of Man in the High Castle. Loved it. Their installation at Comic-Con was so cool. They were everywhere. Yeah. There was one thing in there where, like, they went in there and they started treating you like this was how it was. And the season 2 trailer looks just as cool. It was a weird installation. It was dark at points. Like, you're putting kids in this thing? Wow. It was cool. I dug it, so I'm high on it.
Okay, so I just want to make sure that I watched the right thing, because what I saw was basically a singular clip, one scene that involved a car and a trunk and somebody rolling out of that trunk.
Yes.
That is all we got, right?
Pretty much, yep.
Okay, just making sure. I thought it looked awesome.
But Amazon...
I did not finish season 1, though. I started season 1, and I felt like... slow burn. I feel like that's just like a lame excuse for when somebody doesn't want to pick up the pace because they realize they have to stretch a narrative out as opposed to giving us something to really, like, chew on each episode. So I wasn't super intrigued. I thought this looked interesting, but I don't know that it was enough to drag me back into the show.
Okay.
I'm high just because I like the first season a lot, so I'm looking forward to season 2.
And Amazon, I mean, I'm sure you saw it there on Harbor and at Comic-Con. They spent all their budget, Amazon did, on the installation. Everything Amazon promoted there was Man in High Castle.
Wow.
For sure. It was
Amazon
cool.
has a lot of money.
They've always pushed hard for Man in High Castle. Yeah.
That's the number one watched show.
I remember, like, Comic-Con last year, there were, like, people kept sliding things under my door and they were all for Man in the High Castle. And I was like, that is a little weird.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. We're just going to go into some traditional television news. None of this actually dropped at Comic-Con. Just so happened to drop during Comic-Con week or before we actually got to Comic-Con. So we're going to still do it high and low style because that's how we're doing it today. Sinead, what's first?
All right. First up is season 2 Narcos trailer.
Oh, I'm in.
Oh, my God.
God, I'm so excited.
It looks so good. I was so bummed when the first, like, Instagram thing went up. And I was like, oh, come on. We know this. But, like, be more original. This looks stupid good.
This looks like an action movie. Doesn't even look like a show. And there was this weird movie a little while back with what's the guy's name? What's the act? Matthew Fox. And it was like they were all from seeing the same assassination from, like, a different viewpoint.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think it might have Cody. Vantage point. Makes sense. I called it viewpoint. It's actually vantage point. This has a lot of, that movie wasn't very good, but a lot of it is you're seeing these, like, this flashpoints, these explosions, all these things going on in this you know, this Medellin, Colombia. And that show, if you didn't watch season 1 of Narcos, get your head out of your butts, because that show is fantastic. Yes, we know what happens because it's historical and it only took place 25 years ago, but unbelievable. How well they do this show. I'm so excited.
I can't wait. I think it looks awesome. I am just chomping at the bit until September. Yeah. What did you think?
I'm here. I'm a high. I mean, I feel like that show immediately immerses you into just the world of Medellin, Colombia, is because it's shot in Colombia. Yeah. I was looking at it, I'm like, this kind of looks like South, you know, like somewhere I would see this in Colombia. It is.
When it comes out, we'll binge it and we'll do a full series review here on the show for sure. Mm-hmm. So, Shanasti, what do you think of it? Do you don't watch Narcos?
Oh, so good.
Do you Narcos, bro?
Yeah, you Narcos?
I've never seen it, ever. Ooh,
it's an easy binge. Really easy
super
binge.
Super binge, yeah. All right, what's next?
Making a Murderer will return with more episodes.
So apparently they're going to come back because they're getting a trial. Or at least this is like the process of them trying to get the trial for Stephen Avery. Mm-hmm. I'm still on the fence. If you guys haven't watched the thing, I mean, I still don't know if he did or he didn't. It's such a well done show. Mm-hmm. So I'm high, but at the same time, it's like, is it gonna be blue balls again? Do you know what I mean?
Well, I don't think you would make a second season if there wasn't gonna be some sort of resolution. I think they learned that with this, they learned that with Serial, the podcast. So I wasn't as high on the show as you guys were. I felt like it could have been condensed and it felt a little bit meandering. I feel like I'm gonna like season 2 more because as opposed to having a decade to sort of like collate a story and feeling like there's so much there to tell, I feel like this is going to be tighter, more concise. I'm more excited about season 2 than I was at the end of season 1.
Okay.
Yeah, it's interesting. Yeah, I mean, I really enjoyed it, but after watching the people versus OJ, you know, Making a Murderer, I felt like even though that was a 8 to 10 hours itself, like this was 10 hours. This was 10 hours. I felt like that felt like it deserved the 10 hours, whereas Making a Murderer, as good as it was, I binged it like in a few days. Mm-hmm. I felt like it could have been a little short, maybe a couple
Hell
episodes
yeah,
short. So like you said, Sasha, I hope it's a little bit tighter.
Oh
but I still like. I still enjoyed it.
I so disagree with both of you.
I'm with kind of Sinead on this one. I love
absolutely
it.
Hung on to every single last word of Making a Murderer. I watched the last 3 episodes twice because I wanted to make sure I got it all, and I loved it. But that's the thing, is because we had to like get to know him, and that's why so many of us like felt for him. Which, if you pay attention, the first half of that season is really like exposition, and that's why now everyone is so hyped on a season 2, because we all like feel sorry for this guy, and we all don't know whether or not he did it.
Yeah,
I care more about Adnan Syed though. Like I want more of a resolution to Serial than I do to this.
Same thing. All right. Sinead, what's next? I'm letting you take this one, girl.
Oh, Rihanna. Rihanna's being cast as the screaming girl in Bates Motel's 5th and final season.
So can we get a reenactment of how this was announced?
Yeah, I would like to see that, Sinead.
So,
in 5, okay. 3, 2, 1, go.
Yes, it's me. It's your girl, Riri, and guess what this bad bitch about to do? About to check into the Bates Motel real soon. And guess what? I'm be playing Marion. Mm-hmm. I love you, Comic-Con. Sorry for the bedroom lighting. I'm hanging out at home. Bye.
Sinead de Vries, everybody. Let's hear it for her, guys. Showmanship.
Absolute showmanship. We don't need clips on this show. We don't need no stinky clips.
I literally think that's pretty much like word for word, because I just did a story on it today. But yeah, she revealed it via a video message that looked like from her phone, and she's super excited on it. It's like her biggest acting role to date. I don't know if she has the chops for it, but I mean,
she didn't convince you in Battleship.
No.
But you didn't believe that Rihanna was a bad Navy woman that knew how to like load missiles?
I think Rihanna is a bad bitch. I do think she's a bad bitch. So I think that maybe this could be a good role for her.
Interesting. All right. I mean, just the way you did that makes me so upset with the obnoxiousness of it. So I'm going to go low on it. But Sinead's impression is the highest of the highs from all this. Who needs a Luke Cage trailer when you got Sinead acting like Rihanna?
You know why? Because she's a teen. I think this is actually really smart, interesting casting. Uh-huh. I love it. It makes perfect sense. I look forward to watching her get killed.
Okay.
Spoiler alert.
David Griff?
Yeah.
Yeah,
let's watch it,
let's
folks.
Let's do it. Okay, Sinead, what's next?
Jon Stewart on Stephen Colbert.
Oh.
It, You know what it does? You know why I'm going to make this a low? No, hold on. Hold on. Hold on.
You guys.
Hold
on.
Go with me here. Go with me here for a second. It's a low because I miss him so damn much.
Yeah, it was rough.
And that all I got was a tease. Okay. I got, HBO told us that he was going to be.
He's coming, isn't he?
Yeah, but he's just doing election coverage. He should have been doing the conventions.
Oh, yeah.
They should have had him on HBO doing Democratic and Republican national conventions and doing a once a week show leading up. I don't care if it's Last Week Tonight and then Jon Stewart. I'll watch the full hour. Him on Stephen Colbert was such a refresher. It just made me miss The Daily Show.
I'm with you.
It just made me miss Jon Stewart.
Huge high for me but I see your point, and I think you made it beautifully. He is so smart.
It's just so much better than everybody else.
So much. And there are people that are great at what they do. Yes. I love John Oliver personally, but Jon Stewart is like, it's like he reaches into the collective mind of all the people I respect the most and says the words that I want somebody to say, but I'm not smart enough to form myself.
Yeah.
God, I loved it.
Well, I feel like Jon Stewart could go. I like Oliver. Oliver seems like he's trying to make a joke all the time. It's always a big, it's a setup. It's like I'm building to a setup and boom, here's a joke. And he's probably one of the best on TV about it. But Jon Stewart, he can go off, the projector and just have a conversation with you and just talk, and you're just glued to him. Great. I don't know if Oliver can do that. Maybe he can, but I feel like I'm always glued to Jon Stewart.
And the other thing about Jon Stewart is he isn't, like you said, it's not just that he's always building to a joke. It's not just that he's always funny. Mm-hmm. When he would speak about like mass shootings, when he would talk about different things in culture, like he has such a good heart.
Yep.
And you could see that in his coverage also. Like he has so much empathy. I love him. God, I love him.
So good. So high. All right, last one, Sinead.
The newest The Get Down trailer.
I am so down with The Get Down. No.
Okay.
Is that trailer?
I'm bummed. I know, I'm bummed.
Really?
Because here's why.
Is this
going to
be your vinyl again?
No, stop. Nothing could be my vinyl again. I'm really excited for The Get Down, and I loved the first teaser trailer, and then they put out an extended trailer, and it got really into like the disco thing, and it became this whole other beast, and it looked incredibly proscenium. It looked like a stage production, which is so much of what Baz Luhrmann did with the Red Curtain trilogy. And sometimes I think it's great, and sometimes I don't think it's as effective. And in this particular instance, this trailer made me less excited than I was. Because before, I was hyped.
Yeah.
And now I'm like, all right, I'm still going to do it. I still hope it's good, but I have less belief in it than I did a week ago.
Interesting. All right. I'm somewhere in between. Because I thought it was awesome. I loved it. I'm going to give it a high. But there were points of it where I was like, is this going to be a musical? Like, am I going to see a freaking musical?
Well, I love a good musical. And I love an unexpected musical.
Yeah.
But like this, it just, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I'm not just hating on it because I'm mad the vinyl's canceled, which I am. But it's just the trailer. We're judging the trailer. The trailer looked like I was expecting more of a cross between Straight Outta Compton, meets vinyl and combine those two, that's what you get. It doesn't seem to have that present. Marty, we can criticize vinyl all you want, but Mario Scorsese directed the pilot. Mario Scorsese is one of the greatest directors of all time. He has that influence. Baz Luhrmann's very good too. I'm curious to see how the pilot is when we see the full episode, but just seeing that trailer I wasn't impressed with it quite yet, but I'm still holding up hope for it. We haven't seen it yet. We're just judging the trailer.
So I have a feeling it's going to be closer to Romeo and Juliet. I think that's probably what he's going for.
Yeah, I can totally see that.
Which was a musical in a lot of ways.
Maybe to change our expectations.
So I think it's going to be more like that, and I think it is a musical in the Baz Luhrmann way because that's what he likes doing. I'm okay with that. My problem was it felt very fake. It felt like... It didn't feel immersive at all.
There
was
definitely like a Footloose moment in there. Mm-hmm. Not a Footloose. Footloose. The daughter goes against her father, and he's a preacher, and it's church. And
I do love Giancarlo Esposito, though.
Yeah.
It's good to see him in there.
What do you think, Sinead?
I mean, I don't know. Like, I feel like I'm so hyped on this. Like, I was so excited about it that I don't want to like really admit that the trailer. Also, I can agree with a lot of what you're saying. The trailer kind of felt a little bit fake and at times forced a little bit. But my God, I have so much hope for this. Yeah. I want this to be good. I think we all do.
We've all been wanting a music show to work. Yeah. Vinyl, Miss, Roadies, an even bigger Miss. David will
defend. I mean, that's an opinion. This is one opinion of, you know.
On David's gravestone, when he dies at a very old age, like 101, it's just going to be like,
I still live
life vinyl. Like, it's just going to have it on.
No, it's just going to be like my name, and it's going to be hashtag vinyl. Or hashtag bring back vinyl. Somebody will bring it back. Somebody will bring it back.
Bring back vinyl.
All right. Let's, Cody, let's throw up the spoiler image there on the screen. Guys, for the next like 5 to 6 minutes, we are going to do Preacher and Mr. Robot review, full spoiler review. So let's start with Preacher. I can't tell you how like the decrescendo of this show is getting to me. Like, I'm getting more and more disappointed. I thought this was gonna fill my Game of Thrones. I thought this episode, like, at episode 5, I was like, finally, we're getting to somewhere. This is gonna be awesome. And then since then, it's just gone downhill. Now the nice girl at the church.
Oh, that was
murders
such a. Oh, come on.
The mayor. Are you kidding me? She won't even not feed her kids. Like, she's like organic, vegan-free mom at the table. And she's like, this guy's a little too nice to me. And he's kind of a stalker. And like, he wants to love me. But you know what? I'm tired of him. So I'm going to feed him to a fucking vampire. Excuse my language. I know I'm not supposed to swear. But that was so dumb.
Yep.
It was so dumb.
No. So I went back and I watched the episode that I hadn't seen. And then I watched last night's. And I was sitting there going, like, I'll be honest, I was
sorry, there's been a hair on your mic this whole time.
Thank you. I found myself checking my phone almost constantly. Like, as the episode was going, I was like, oh my God, I need something else to distract myself because I am so not entertained, not enthralled. The character departures are ridiculous.
Departures? They're totally new characters.
It's ridiculous.
What, now the nice girl with the khaki pants that works at the IHOP is now a killer? Are you kidding me?
The show is like...
I'm off it, Dave. I'm
going to the end of this season and then I'm done.
Yeah, I think so.
It's weird because I agree with you. I don't think the show's gotten worse. I really don't. I think... No, listen to me. Hear me out. I think what's happened is the show has stayed the same. I'm still entertained by it, but I think because right now... Sasha, you're in the middle of binging Stranger Things. Josh and I already finished it. We also have Night Of on, which Night Of might be the best show on television right now that's currently airing.
So I didn't watch last night's yet because I was watching this.
I think we're watching all these shows. Then we watch Preacher, and Preacher is good. But I think when you compare it to Stranger Things, you compare it to Night Of, especially Night Of, it's like Preacher's good. There's some craziness in it. I actually enjoy the cast. I like their chemistry, but it's not that good. I think if there was nothing else, those two shows weren't on, this is all we had post Game of Thrones. We might still not like it as much, but I don't know if we'd be as harsh to it.
Okay, I can see what you're saying. But I mean, what you're talking about is like last night it was 11:30. I had to be up at 7 and I'm sitting there and I call my best friend and I was like, should we watch the last two episodes of Stranger Things right now?
Yeah.
And because God, I want to go back to it. I want to revisit it. This feels like a slog. Yeah. I don't think it's about 100%. If it was a comparison of like this or this. I am judging it as a show and as a show, I don't care about the characters.
Do not.
I don't care about the story.
Nope.
And I feel like the only reason I'm watching it is so that when you guys say, what did you think of it last night? I can say, well, when I'm watching her feed dead animals or animals to Cassidy, I was getting sort of upset. But I also kind of like Cassidy as like the one character. So I sort of was okay with it. But then that thing happened. And then I was like, fuck this show. Sorry.
That's two F-bombs in one review.
Sorry, Mrs. Griffin.
For the whole show.
Oh, jeez, you guys.
Adam, I'm going to get yelled at by Adam as soon as we...
Let's not talk about Preacher anymore.
Okay,
there won't be any more F-bombs.
Let's go on to the show that is way better. And I'm still
where the F is for fun and the F is for fierce storytelling. Yeah.
I need to ask
F
you a question about this. Speaking of F
Mr.
words,
Mr. Robot.
Sasha.
Yeah. Go ahead.
So I noticed Mr. Robot is good. First of all, let's get this out of the way. Awesome episode.
Oh,
love
man.
The season so far. Everything's great about it. I'm starting to buy into more of the fan theories. There's a lot of popular fan theories going on right now about how he might probably like in a mental institution and you know, maybe Craig Robinson is his psychiatrist or whatever. Yeah, I think that's probably right. But Sasha, I'm confused. So in the first episode, they don't mute the F. Well, they just mute. They don't go beep. They just say an F bomb. They just silence it.
Yeah.
The Breaking Bad did the same thing.
Yeah.
But in the first episode, they didn't mute them. They dropped 3 F-bombs in the premiere, and in this one, they're all silent. Now, why is that?
Okay, so there's a couple of different possibilities. Number one is you can curse, but you have to pay a fine to the FCC. So there are also ways where, like, if you have your standards and practices lawyers work really, really hard, like, because I asked FX how they got the MF in there, and it was just a debate with standards and practices, and it was an FCC conversation, and they were going off of, like, the legality of it being a true story. So it's a combination of, do you want to pay the money for it, or can you make a strong enough case for the storytelling to have it be okay.
Interesting.
The conventions of network and cable television are totally shifting. And I think this show, because of the popularity, USA is willing to go a lot further to make certain things happen.
Okay.
So you can, like, it's not something that a Showtime ever has to think about, but obviously with USA, it's like, how much is this fight worth for us? And with this show, like, there's other ways to perhaps get around it. Like, okay, well, we're going to say it, but we're going to bleep it. Or we're going to say it, but we're going to mute it. Or we're going to say it, and we're going to say it three times, and we're going to pay a lot of money for that one episode because it's the most important episode probably of our season.
Okay. Well, thanks for that. Yeah, sorry about that. No, I was just curious about that.
That's a good question.
I'm sure the fans notice that, too. It's like, how come it's being, okay.
Let's just, like, we don't have a ton of time, but I think the beautiful part about this episode is, I think Rami Malek, like, earned an Emmy, another Emmy nom.
Oh my God.
Just straight off this episode alone. That, like, monologue in the Christ group is, I mean, it's something like that they write into movies. That's something that had a very Fight Club feeling to it, right? And it's something so friggin' powerful about the scene, that scene, and then the scene with Angela at the dinner table with the bosses, that just, this show has an unbelievable tone. Congrats to Sam Esmail on just really knocking this out of the park. You guys can just go off that, but I mean, I really think we're all on the same page here. We're rolling into an amazing season of television.
Dude, it's so good. And like you said, Sam Esmail is killing it. And the thing that I also found so interesting about this episode was, I am starting to look at every character as a an apparition, as like possibly like a, like just a ghost in his brain, which is very cool. And also, like, the way they show you sleep deprivation felt like
I was in pain.
So
watching that. Yeah, I was in pain.
Going like, Alexa, what time is it? And because you know you've been there.
Oh my God.
4:03, I have to be up in 2 hours. Yeah. And I can't get any sleep.
Yeah.
Right?
That was genius. Genius.
Yeah, she's in a dark place. I mean, what she's going through. But it's good. Yeah, it's just eating pills out of your puke, your own puke, and eating.
I have this moment of every episode feeling like I'm pulled out of a snow globe and I'm looking at this alternate reality in the snow globe. Like, there's Mr. Robot. There's all those crazy characters, and they're stuck in like a Truman Show. Almost, and I have no idea what the hell's going on, but I'm loving every second.
I really like what Portia Doubleday's character is going through, you know, like going into the executive world and learning that. Like, I like how she shows up to the meeting thinking, like, she's got to put out, I guess. Like, she was looking good, ready to go. And then it's like, oh, this is a business meeting. And then learning that these guys are the ones who are responsible for what happened to her parent. Like, it's good.
It's so good. And here's the thing. So with a show like this, I feel like there are so many unanswered questions. Mm-hmm. But based on the season finale last season, I feel like we're going to get something that we like. The payoff at the end of these 10 episodes, I feel like, is going to be huge. Huge. I love
it. Huge.
Okay,
let's go. We have one Twitter question today because I love this Twitter question so much. I knew we wouldn't have a lot of time because we did so much on Comic-Con. Sinead, what is the question?
At Cap'n Mormon tweets in. I like that, by the way. It's very clever. Classic question. First TV crush, mine was Kim Possible, which is now developed into Sansa Stark.
Mm-hmm. So Stewart is 14 years old.
Yeah.
There.
My first crush was most definitely Alyssa Milano on Who's the Boss.
Oh.
And then that transitioned around the same time into Kelly Kapowski on Saved by the Bell.
Nice.
Which then around the same time was Alexis Mack, or what was the girl on Nickelodeon?
Alex Mack.
Alex Mack, thank you very much, was total crush on her. And there's a little part of me that had a tiny little crush on Melody in Hey Dude.
Wow. So I'm totally going to date myself with this answer, but the answer was Alex P. Keaton, which I know is one of the things that Macuga and I have in common, because if he had a male crush, that was probably his.
100% still a male crush.
Him and Charlie Hunnam. So in love. Oh, fuck yeah. This is what. Jeez.
He had a Charlie Hunnam moment, too.
Dang it.
This is a bad episode. Sorry, guys.
I had a Charlie Hunnam moment at Comic-Con, too.
Oh, stop. Okay. Anyway, so I was so in love with Michael J. Fox that my parents picked me up from summer camp, and my mom, like, I got in the car and I could tell something was heavy on her mind, and we drove away from the camp, and I was already kind of sad because I was leaving camp, and we pulled over to the side of the road, and my mom was like, honey, I have to tell you something. And she pulls out, I think it was like a People magazine, and on the cover, Michael J. Fox had gotten married while I had been at camp, and I broke down. I sobbed. My dad held me, and I was like, oh, because I thought that Alex P. Keaton and I thought I was going to be Sasha P. Keaton.
That's an excellent story.
Absolutely. David Griffin. happened?
First, it was from Star Trek Next Generation. Hi. It was Marina Sirtis who played Counselor Troi. And as a 6 to 8 year old, I don't think I had gone through the stages yet, but I understood enough that to see a woman with her chest out all the time. That was good. And that developed into Dana Scully, Gillian Anderson from The X-Files, who I've developed a new crush for her as she's gotten older. I think she looks just looks beautiful. Yeah. And then most beautiful woman in the world to me is Padma Lakshmi. And there's just I look at her. That's just she's perfect.
Yeah.
I would take it on. I take on the kid. Her. I mean, I just I'd love to. I'm there, Padma. If you need somebody to help, she doesn't.
You want that Salman Rushdie? She's second sloppy seconds.
That's, I'll take it.
There was that little part of me too. It was right around the same age. Party of Five. Lacey Chabert in Party of Five because we were both like 15 at the time.
Wow.
Oof, man, she had like. Anyway, dating me a little bit, but man.
Lacey Chabert. I'm surprised you didn't go Jen Love Hewitt. Love.
Well, wait. Jennifer Love Hewitt in Trojan Wars, but that wasn't a TV show.
All right.
Although Jessica Biel in Seventh Heaven.
Wait, Shinasty, we need yours. yours? She's going to be like.
Drake and Degrassi.
Well, my very, very first TV crush was actually from Degrassi, The Next Generation, and it was Jake Epstein. He played Craig. Mm. That was my first one, but the one that really has stuck with me till even to this day, the first time I was ever obsessed with a fictional character was Chuck Bass on Gossip Girl.
Oh, yeah.
I literally
Who's the actor
used
that plays
to,
that?
Ed Westwick.
Okay.
I literally used to cry, like, bawl my eyes out at the idea of dating somebody like Chuck Bass. And the worst part about it was that he was the biggest asshole on the entire show.
Adam's leaving.
Adam's out. He's done enough for him. He's heard enough.
We're
He's
literally going to get the worst lecture ever. Yeah. He was
remember
the
that
biggest
FCC conversation poop we had.
Yeah, he was just awful, rude, didn't know how to treat women. But one thing stuck in his love for Blair Waldorf throughout the entire show just was like, I needed a Chuck Bass in my life.
So good. So right. good.
Guys, Twitter questions, hashtag and Collider TV Talk. Send them in. Thank you for that one, at Captain Mormon, because we love that one so much. Love talking about those early crushes. All right, we're going to go to the pick of the week. This week, we don't have a lot of time. Goldberg's, ABC, one of my favorite comedies. It's come out in the last couple years.
Watch it. Done.
Do it. Crush it. It's funny. Jeff Garland, 80s family. Reminds me of my own family. My mom is Beverly Goldberg. Watch it. It's amazing. Okay, that's it for us here on Collider TV Talk. Guys, we did a huge Comic-Con roundup. I'm exhausted about talking about it, but I loved spending my Monday again with all these fine people. Sinead, where can the good people find you?
I'm online at Sinead de Vries and at thatsosinead.com. Right now, I will be apologizing to Adam for dropping the last swear word of the show. I swore I wasn't going to do it in my head, but I totally did. And then also, I'm here on Mondays hosting TV Talk, on Fridays hosting Movie Talk, over the weekends hosting Collider Mailbag. Also, to everyone who came out to the Collider meet and greet on Thursday, thank you so much from the bottom of my heart. I had a blast. I think I hung out there for like 4.5 hours. Yeah. Ridiculous. I was pretty hammered at the end of it, but no worries because I had so much fun with all of you. And post your pictures, please. Thank you so much.
David Griffin.
I'm on Twitter at GriffinDE as well as on Instagram with the same. I was just thinking about what Sinead says, not what's going down my back right now. I had a great time meeting everybody at the Collider meetup. It was so fun talking to everybody. And people come up to you and they say they appreciate your opinions and say what they appreciate what you have to bring to the table. It means a lot because, you know, a lot of times we're up here, you know, we have all these really talented people up here. I don't know if I'm saying anything that makes sense or that's important. And you know, it's nice to
Tell
have somebody validate
it,
for it. Right?
Tell me about
yeah,
it.
So I appreciate that. And yeah, just look at all of our videos. Look at Josh running from dinosaurs.
Sasha Perl-Raver.
I am at Sasha Perl-Raver on Instagram and Twitter. And I just want to say, I'm so sorry that I wasn't there. I will be there next time. I apologize. I heard that, David.
You're
I heard that groan.
You best be there.
Listen, but I am so happy to be back here. Mondays, TV Talk. This is, I love this TV Talk family. You guys are my fave. Thursdays with the Schmoes. And then Friday on FX hosting FX Movie Download.
Guys, I'm Josh Macuga, at Josh Macuga on Twitter and Instagram. Here every Monday doing Collider TV Talk throughout the week, you know, hanging out on Fridays or Saturdays. You guys can always see me on Film HQ, on the Comic-Con HQ Network, and my YouTube channel, The Josh Macuga Show. And like Sasha and Sinead said, David and Sinead said, Sasha wasn't there. I'm sorry, David and Sinead. All the people that saw us at Comic-Con, whether it was at the meet and greet or all during the week, or if you came to see us at the stage, you just saw us on the floor and you said something and we grabbed a picture, we shared a moment. Thank you for watching these shows. Without you guys, these shows are not possible. And we really do appreciate you from the bottom of our heart, especially Johnny O, who brought me a poster of all the schmoes. He printed it out for us and brought it to the bar. Aww. Unbelievable. You guys bought me some shots, bought me some beers, and I really, really appreciate it. I'm almost going to cry. So thank you so much, guys. It really, really does mean a lot to all of us. Until the next time, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.